Today's sermon is really about serving our community. We actually started a small little Bible study in our building. I felt like God was just saying, hey, you need to start reaching the people in your community, the place where you spend the majority of your time, which is where you live. You need to start developing relationships. You need to start representing God wherever you live, because that's where you spend the most time, except work. That's another place we should probably be developing relationships and be sharing Christ. It's a little bit more challenging, it seems, these days to do that at work because, you know, there's so many policies and things that you can do and can't do. But at home, usually that's a place where you can freely be able to share, even though it has its challenges, of course. It's not, sometimes it will be well received, the message, and sometimes it will not. But we know that as believers, one of the tasks and responsibilities that God gives us is to share about His love, share the message of Jesus Christ with others. And so with this little Bible study group, we've been talking about how we are able to engage our community to make a difference for Christ. You know, if we begin to engage our community, we begin to develop relationships, and through those relationships, we begin to share the good news with others. And so this is kind of where this message came from. And I just wanted to share with you just a little bit of my thoughts and kind of what I've been processing lately regarding how to reach our communities. And really, I feel like that's what the church is for. That's why we gather. We gather because the desire and the task of the church is to reach out, reach our communities with the good news of Christ. And so what I would like to do is to talk about four ways in which we can engage our communities. And one way is not better than the others. They're just different. And it just depends on the need that arises. That's kind of the approach that we take whenever we are to represent Christ in our community. But before I go into that, let me just take a moment just to say a prayer, okay? Dear Heavenly Father God, we want to thank you for this wonderful day. I pray that you would speak through me. I pray that through your word, through the scriptures, we're able to see how you engage your community, how you preach and heal and carry out your ministry, so we can have an example of how we are to engage our own communities for the sake of the kingdom. I pray that you would teach us this morning, and it's your name that I pray. Amen. So there's a really fancy word called incarnational ministry. That sounds very fancy. But let me just break it down. It has some Latin roots. So in is the same thing as in English, which means in. Incarnus, which is the second word for this word incarnational, stems from the word Latin word carnis, which is in the flesh. So you put these two words together and it becomes in the flesh. And so incarnational ministry basically is taking the model of how Jesus served his communities, which was in the flesh. It was Emmanuel, God with us. Emmanuel was God, right? He was born of a virgin. And even though he was God, he came down into our world, broken world, and lived among us. He lived among us for 33 years. 30 of those years were rather silent. We don't hear much about Jesus except for his birth, right? We hear about the story of his birth in the Gospels, and we like to retell them during Christmas time. We also hear a story when he was 12 years old and he was kind of going back and forth with the Pharisees. But besides those two accounts, we don't really hear much about Jesus in the first 30 years. But then he was very active in 3 years during his ministry. And he was serving. He was doing all kinds of ministry. He was calling his disciples. He even died on the cross during those 3 years. So we would say that out of the 3 years, that's 10%. And 90%, we really don't hear much about what Jesus was doing. He was just with his people. He was living life. He was just a regular person, a carpenter, had an earthly father and mother, had brothers and sisters, was in the community. He grew up just a regular person. But we don't really hear much about Jesus until God calls him to carry out the ministry for which he was called to carry out. And that was only 3 years. And so in this message, I would just kind of like to cover the four ways in which Jesus engaged his community. And I think it can help us to kind of understand how we are to engage our community. And the first way that we engage our community is doing for. Doing for is the first way. And this is basically helping those that cannot help themselves. We look around our community, right? We see all the need. And we encounter certain circumstances where we try to help those who cannot help themselves, right? The church rallies together around certain causes. They see the need community. They strive to be the hands and feet of Jesus. And they say, there's a need. There's a need. We need to help these people because they cannot help themselves, right? And one of the examples that I will use, just because I feel like it is a condition, a situation that we all have encountered personally, or maybe someone else that we know has been in it. Or we may be driving down the road and we hit a cross section here in Houston and we encounter a homeless person. But for the most part, we have all encountered someone who is homeless that doesn't have a home. Right? And sometimes we'll give them a dollar or we'll give them some food. And so doing for really just meets the immediate need. And sometimes we have to meet that immediate need. It could be maybe clothing. It could be the least of society. Jesus talks about the least of society, which are those that don't have food, that are naked, the imprisoned. He talks about the hungry and the thirsty. And we do for those who are lacking the basic essentials. So God calls us as a church to fill that need. And so we become the hands and feet of Jesus. We start doing for and working on God's behalf to fill that need. Some of the examples that I can think of programs or different churches and the programs that they take on to do for others is maybe like after school tutoring or sheltering the homeless. There's food drives, medical and dental screenings. And the list of activities goes on. Some of the biblical examples that I have of Jesus doing for others, basically helping those that cannot help themselves, is when God delivered Egypt from slavery, right? They were in slavery for 400 years and they were being oppressed, and God intervened and delivered them out of a situation in which they cannot deliver themselves out of because there was such heavy oppression. The passion of Jesus Christ, Him dying on the cross for our sins, is something that we cannot do for ourselves, the forgiveness of sins. We cannot remove the sin in our life. It was something that we cannot do for ourselves, so Jesus Christ had to come into our world and die and pay the price for something that we can't do on our own. There's also sicknesses. We see how Jesus was able to heal all kinds of sicknesses. He gave sight to the blind. He healed various diseases and torments, the demon-possessed, the epileptics, the paralytics. They were in a situation where they cannot heal themselves. So Jesus had to intervene and heal them. And so we have all these examples of how Jesus healed, how He gave His life on the cross for our sins, how He delivered people from the oppression that they were going through. And so as the church, we are also called to do for others what they cannot do for themselves. So the good thing about doing for others is that we actually feel a real need in the community. We use the financial and material resources of the church to make the lives of the people in our community a better place. One of the negatives about just doing for is it's easy to fulfill the immediate need with finances and resources, but we go back into our regular jobs, and oftentimes the person stays in the same situation that they were before. And also sometimes we can be disconnected to the person, really don't get to know the person at a deeper level, because sometimes we'd rather just give resources and finances to the problem and just to keep things on the surface. We don't have to engage at a deeper level. So there's positives and negatives to everything, right? So the second way that Jesus engages the community when He lived here on earth, and which He calls the church to do and follow His example, is in advocating for those in need. challenging the injustice that we see. So I want to give an example. So let's say we encounter a homeless person, right? And we give them food, we give them finances, and we fulfill their immediate need. But we find out that the person really cannot get on their feet because there's something that is blocking their progress. And that's why they've been on the streets for the majority of their life. So we spark up a conversation with them, and we end up finding out that there is something on their record, something that they were falsely accused of 20 years ago. You know, they claim that they were falsely accused. And so this little incident on their record is preventing them from getting ahead in life, from getting a job because of the background checks. And so it's really holding them back. And so there's a member in the church, we'll say, that has experience in legal issues. And maybe we can say he's a lawyer. So oftentimes, God will use the expertise and the resources of the church to try to advocate for others. And this is being for. And we see that Jesus advocated. He fought for the powerless. He fought for the voiceless, for those who did not have a voice, for those who did not have influence in society. Some of the real examples that we see of the church being for others, basically is being their voice, being their influence. Some of the real examples that we see here in our city is fighting against human trafficking. This is a hotbed of human trafficking. We see orphanages, right? Now, God has a heart for the orphan because the orphan is powerless. He's voiceless. And so there's organizations that make sure that the orphan is given a family that will nurture the child and will take care of them. There's also ministries for the falsely imprisoned. There's organizations that go out and make sure that the person that was falsely accused and has been in jail, that they get the right representation. And we see cases of that happening, of people that fight for others, others who do not have a voice, and others who are powerless. And so some of the examples that we see in the Bible about of Jesus advocating for others are the woman caught in the act of adultery. Right? Everybody wanted to accuse her, but Jesus went to her defense. She was a woman that didn't have a lot of influence in society. Jesus advocated for the prostitute who washed, kissed, and anointed Jesus' feet in the house of the Pharisee. Now, she was kind of being looked down on by the people there that had surrounded Jesus around the table. And this prostitute walks in and begins to anoint and wash Jesus' feet. And she advocates for and says, look, she was the only one that treated me in this way. All of you, you haven't treated me the way she has. So that is advocating for her because she didn't have a voice. We see Jesus confronting the oppression of the Pharisees. They would like to load the burdens onto others that they weren't willing to carry themselves. We see so many instances of Jesus confronting the oppressive practices of the Pharisees. We see how he healed on the Sabbath, right? Jesus was able to see the person first before going to any policies or rules that were ingrained in the culture, because at the heart of his ministry was people. So who cares about keeping the Sabbath? We have a person that needs to be healed and is sick. In a couple cases, we see that there was a woman that had an infirmity for 18 years. Her back was not straight. She was bent over, and she'd been like that for 18 years. And Jesus healed her on the Sabbath, and the Pharisees criticized him for that. So we have many examples of how Jesus advocated for the voiceless and the powerless. I won't go into more details, but I think you get an idea of what I'm talking about. And Jesus calls the church to advocate for others. So he calls us to be for others and also to do for others what they cannot do for themselves. Which leads me to the third posture, the third approach of how we are to engage our community, the people around us, is doing with. Doing with. This is walking with others so they can grow in maturity. So in the first two approaches, they really have to get it back on their feet initially. Because if they don't have food, if they don't have clothing, they really need their basic necessities covered before we can even think about the next step, right? If somebody is really being oppressed and can't move forward and be a productive citizen because of some legal battle they're having. Really, that needs to be handled. And in the process, we can share the love of Christ with others, the church can, and they'll see how we are working on God's behalf and being His hands and feet. That might even draw them to want a relationship with Christ because of our efforts. Doing with is walking alongside others so they can grow in Christian maturity. So this is, we can say, is maybe another step forward. So let's say, and since I'm using the example of the homeless person, I'm just going to continue with this example. I think it's a good example because the homeless person has their need and their lack is at so many different levels that I feel like they're a good example of people that the church can rally around and help in some fashion. But let's say that the homeless person, he has his basic needs covered. They're able to take away this conviction that he has on this record. So now he's clear. Now he is in the open to be able to apply for jobs. He gets a good job and he accepts Christ into his life and he starts on that journey of growing in maturity. He has a lot of potential. God has given him a lot of gifts and talents. Now it's just about taking those hidden gifts, those buried gifts, and getting them out of hiding. And so the individual can begin to grow and fulfill their full potential in life. And in the process, you know, there is discipleship happening. The person is learning about the commandments of Christ and how to follow Him. Possibly the resources, the church comes together and tries to help the individual by referring him or her to someone in a company that is hiring, and they get their foot in the door, and maybe the possibilities for them to have a job. Another way that we can walk alongside others is helping them maybe with some education or some training so they can get back on their feet, or maybe serving as a reference. So there's all kinds of ways that we can do with others. There's a ministry that, I don't know if you've heard of this ministry, but it's helped a lot of people get back on their feet and actually get jobs, but it's called Work Faith Connections. Work Faith Connections has a whole program which they go into this program and they have mock interviews. They help them with their clothes. They connect them with different companies. And so it's a great program. And there's also discipleship where people are learning about Christ. So the best example of Jesus doing with others is walking alongside of them so they can grow in Christian maturity. The best example that I've been able to see is with his disciples. The 3 years that Jesus was with his disciples, he was doing with. Mainly, this approach is, I'm not just going to give them fish, but I'm going to teach them to fish. That way, they're not so dependent on others and they can begin to thrive in life. But we see how Jesus and his disciples, how he walked alongside them, he called them, he prepared them, then sent them out to preach the kingdom and to heal all kinds of sicknesses. Some of the examples that I see here are calling his disciples to follow him and forming them to be fishers of men. They performed ministry together. He admonished them saying, look, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. He empowered them to carry out the same ministry that he was carrying out. So they were able to preach the gospel and also to heal all kinds of diseases in the same way that Jesus did. So he empowered them with the Holy Spirit. And after his resurrection, right, they were empowered with the Holy Spirit, sent out to preach the good news all over the area. And then the good news of Christ was spread out through all the region. He was constantly teaching them, right? He was constantly using parables. Sometimes he kind of had to get on them and rebuke them if they weren't able to understand something that he was saying. And the disciples went out and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word through the accompanying signs. So that's the third example of doing with. So let me just summarize this so we can kind of keep track of it in our minds. The first one was doing for, helping others who can't help themselves, fulfilling an immediate need. The second one was more about advocacy and challenging injustice in our society, which is being for. The third one is doing with, and this is more about walking alongside others so they can grow in Christian maturity. Hey, and I'm not saying either that this is what I'm doing to everybody else and this is not being done to me. I'm also in this process. You know, there's people, I've walked alongside others, but also others have walked alongside me to make sure that I'm growing in Christian maturity. And there's been situations in my life where I was in dire need. Thankfully, I don't think I was ever homeless, but one or two crises could have put me in a real predicament. And I know that happens to a lot of people for different reasons, like health issues, that it causes them to really be in a bad situation where they become really dependent. So none of us are immune. And so, which leads me to the last one, which is being with. And so that's where I got the title of this sermon, which is God is with us. God is here with us. I'm going to explain what the fourth one is. And I guess we can say that the fourth one is the ideal of where we would like to get to. But most likely, as long as we live on this earth, we probably will only see flashes of being with. So in order to explain being with, which is just sharing life with whomever God sends our way, let's say, for example, and this is one of the best ways that I can describe being with. So let's say that we've done everything. The church has rallied around an individual and done everything they possibly can to help this individual. They provided food. They provided clothing. They've advocated for this individual. They maybe paid some legal expenses to make sure their charge was dropped. They've walked with him and shared the word and provided discipleship training. And then something happened that is very discouraging. After all that work, the individual basically ends up back where he started. And we're driving down the street and we see that same individual back on that corner, you know, asking for money. And so, you know, I'm sure for the people that were helping him for that church, it becomes very frustrating, but you know, it happens. You know, it happens constantly. And so it can be a very frustrating situation. And so the church has a decision. We can either go in our separate ways and we find some other ministry that we can be a part of, or we can continue to have a relationship with this individual. And really, this is where being with really starts, because we already know that we can't do anything for the person because we already tried. They aren't looking for anything from the church because they know that they've already seen everything that the church could provide for them. So a church member goes up to the individual and says, look, let's go have some coffee. I'd like to just talk to you. And the homeless person says, yeah, let's go have coffee. So they gather around this table and they're sitting across from one another. And now they're on equal playing ground. The homeless person knows that they can't do anything for me. They already tried. So now they're on level playing field. And this is where being with starts, because now they can just be with one another and really just get to know each other for who they are. Get to know, instead of just knowing them on the surface, really begin a real conversation, because there's no longer any agenda of what can I do for you or what can you do for me. And I feel like this is very important to understand, because this is a relationship that God wants to get to eventually with us. It's kind of like that person that always gives you a call when they need something. It's okay a few times, but after a while, you may even start to avoid the phone calls, or because you know that really want to get to know you. They're just looking for what you can offer them. And I feel like that's the type of relationship God wants with us. He didn't go out looking for the need and trying to fix it. Oh, there's a demon-possessed person. I'm going to go over to them. It just happened. These were people that just came across his path, and he was called because of compassion to minister to their lives so he can change their lives. But this wasn't his primary intent. This wasn't his primary motive to come to earth. His primary motive was to restore relationships. And so being with is the purest form of ministry that we can engage our community with, regardless of all the activities and outreaches that we are part of in our community. Being with should always be central to how we interact with others, because we no longer see the other as some sort of a project to be fixed. But instead, I wrote it down, being with, instead of seeing others as problems and something that needs to be fixed, now it looks at the need and says, it seeks to find beauty, joy, and wisdom in others, when some only discover problems and brokenness that needs fixing. This type sees others not for what they have or don't have, but through their lives, one is able to discover their own need and lack. Have you seen that poor person that for some reason, even they don't have anything, have joy? We encounter others not assuming we have all the solutions, but realizing that God may surprise us and show us through their lack the way to salvation. We engage others with an expectation that we will learn something remarkable and profound. We approach others with a sense of intrigue instead of approaching with a critical eye. So just imagine you're sitting across the table from this homeless person and you have this lens in which you're looking through. You look at the person with intrigue. You look at the person because you want to discover God's wisdom. You want to discover God's beauty in this person. It requires a whole reframing of how we see need. Because at the end of the day, we won't be able to fix all the problems in our community. The only time that we will see everything completely new, everything completely restored, is when Christ comes back for His church and restores earth to perfection. And the reason why being with is so important to understand and where we should strive to go is because that's how we're going to spend eternity with God, just being with. It says in Revelation chapter 21 that when He establishes the new heavens and the new earth, there will be no crying. There will be no sorrow. There will be no death. There will be no sickness. What this means is that there will be no need. God will no longer have to do for. God no longer will have to be for. He will no longer have to walk alongside us and do with. But all God is going to do when He establishes the new heavens and the new earth and returns for the church, and we are lifted up in our glorified bodies, with no brokenness, our bodies will be restored to perfection. There will be no brokenness, no sin. All that we can do with God and one another is to be with. Just be with one another with no agenda, not because we're trying to fix one another or we're trying to see what we can get from the other, but just be with in each other's presence. So in closing, I know that I understand that we'll have to do for others. And we'll have to advocate for others. That's part of ministry. But through all of it, Christ's goal during His life and ministry was to be with His people. That's why it's Emmanuel, God with us. It's not God do for us or God wants to advocate for us. No, it's just God with us. That's His ultimate desire, is a restored relationship, a perfect relationship with His creation. But because of the brokenness, there has to be some of the other stuff that goes along with it. But in the midst of that, we can't forget the person that God has called us to minister to. Any other type of engagement with the world is secondary to being with. And this is God's ultimate desire, is to be with His creation now and forever. At the center of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus is restored relationship with humanity. If the church is to follow Christ, this should be the same aim in our ministry. Any programs or projects that are conducted in the local community should always strive to be with people, because this is the goal of our Lord, is just to be with us. God is Emmanuel, God with us. Amen.